Dr. Jung, we have been discussing in some detail some of the factors in the development of the personality of the individual, and you have very kindly elaborated for us on some of your fundamental concepts, such as the archetype, and at least simply what it means, and certain types of archetypes, such as the anima and the animus. And we try to show, perhaps in our discussion, some of the ways that your ideas may have differed from those of Dr. Freud. Now, another concept or idea that seems to be a very interesting one in your work, at least as I see it, is the term or concept persona. And, of course, this seems to have a lot of relevance to the daily living of the individual. I wonder if you would mind telling us a little bit about how you construe this term persona.
Well, this is a practical concept we need in elucidating people's relation. I noticed with my patients, particularly with people that are in public life, that they have a certain way of presenting themselves. For instance, take the doctor. He has a certain way. For instance, he has good bedside manners, and he behaves as one expects a doctor behaves. He may even identify himself with it and believe that he is what he appears to be.
Yes.
He must appear in a certain form, unless people don't believe that he is a doctor. And so when he's a professor, he's also supposed to behave in a certain way so that it is plausible that he is a professor, you know. So the persona is partially the result of the demands society has. And on the other side, it is a compromise with what one likes to be, or with what, or as one likes to appear, uh-huh. Say.
Yes.
Take, for instance, a parson. He also has his particular manner, and as corresponding to the general expectation, and he behaves also in another way, combined with his persona, that is forced upon him by society in such a way that also his fiction of himself, his idea about himself, is more or less portrayed or represented. So the persona is a certain complicated system of behavior which is partially dictated by society and partially dictated by the expectations or the wishes one nurses oneself.
Yes.
Now, this is not the real personality, in spite of the fact that people will assure you that that is all quite real and quite honest, yet it is not.
Yes.
Now, such a performance or, say, yeah, the performance of the persona is quite all right as long as you know that you are not identical with the way in which you appear.
Yes.
But if you are unconscious of this fact, then you get into sometimes very disagreeable conflicts. Namely, people will can't help noticing that at home, for instance, you are quite different from what you appear to be in public.
Yes.
And people who don't know it stumble over it in the end. They deny that they are like that, but they are like that. They
yes.
are it. And then you don't know, now, which is the real man?
Yes.
Is he the man as he is at home or in intimate relations, or is he the man that appears in public? It is a question of Jekyll and Hyde.
Yes.
Often, yeah. It is such, occasionally there is such a difference that you would almost be able to speak of the double personality.
Yes.
And the more that is pronounced, the more people are neurotic.
Yes.
They get neurotic because they have two different ways, they contradict themselves all the time, And inasmuch as they are unconscious of themselves, they don't know it. They think they're all one. Everybody sees that they are two.
Yeah.
And some know him only from one side, so others know him only from the other side. And then there are situations that clash, because the way you are creates certain situations with people in your relations, and these two situations don't chime in, they are just dissonances.
Yes, yes.
And the more that is the case, the more the people are neurotic.
Yes. Actually, would you say that the individual may even have more than two personas? In other words, could he possibly...
Rarely.
Rarely.
We can't afford it very well to play more than two roles. But there are. There are cases, for instance, where people have up to five different personalities.
Yes.
In cases of dissociation of personality. Where, for instance, the one person, say, call it person A, doesn't know of the existence of the person B, but B knows of A.
Yes.
Or there may be a third personality, C, that doesn't know of the two others.
Yes.
You see, there are such cases in literature.
Yes.
They are rare.
Very
the
rare.
The ordinary case is just an ordinary dissociation of a personality.
Yes.
One calls that a systematic dissociation,
yes,
in contradistinction to the chaotic or unsystematic dissociation you find in schizophrenia.
Yes. Now, you distinguish between the term persona and the term ego. In other words, as you see them, they're two different things.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Now, what is the difference between the term ego, as you see it, and the term
persona?
Well,
you see, the ego is supposed to be the representative of the real person. But
real
as I say, for instance, in the case where B knows of A, but A doesn't know of B,
yes,
in that case, one would say the ego is more on the side of C.
Yes.
Because the ego has a more complete knowledge, and
yes,
A is a split of personality.
Yes. Now, you also use the term self.
Yes.
Now, the word self, then, would this have a different meaning than, say, ego or
persona? Yes, oh,
yes,
quite. Oh, yes. You see, when I say self, then you mustn't think of I myself, because that is only your empirical self, and
yes,
that is covered by the term ego.
Ego, yes.
But when it is matter of the self, then it is matter of a personality that is more complete than the ego, because the ego is only consists of what you are conscious of.
Yes, yes, your awareness.
Yeah, what you know to be yourself.
Yes.
For instance, in our example, B that knows A, and A doesn't know B, B is relatively in the position of the self.
Yes.
Namely, the self is on the one side the ego, on the other side the unconscious personality, which everybody is in the possession of everybody, not in the possession. Very often it is just the other way around, that the unconscious is in possession of consciousness.
Yes, yes.
But that is a different case. Now, you see, while I am talking, I am conscious of what I say,
yes,
I am conscious of myself, yet only to a certain extent. Quite a lot of things happen. For instance, I make gestures. I'm not conscious of them.
Yes.
They happen unconsciously. You can see them.
Yes.
I may say or use words, and I can't remember at all having used those words, or even at the moment I'm not conscious of them.
Yes.
So any amount of unconscious things occur in my conscious condition. I'm never wholly conscious of myself.
Yes.
While I'm trying, for instance, to elaborate an argument, at the same time, there are unconscious processes that continue, perhaps a dream which I have had the last night.
Yes.
Or a part of myself thinks of God knows what.
Yes.
Or of a trip I'm going to take, or of such and such people I have seen, or when I am at the, writing a paper, I'm continuing writing that paper in my mind without knowing it.
Yeah.
You can discover these things, say, in dreams, or if you are clever in immediate observation of an individual, then you see in the gestures or in the expression in the face that there is what one calls une arrière-pensée,
yes.
Something behind consciousness.
Yes.
So that you have finally the feeling, well, that man has something up his sleeve.
Yes.
And you can even ask him now, what are you really thinking of? You're thinking all the time something else, yet he's not conscious of it. Or he may be. There are, of course, great individual differences. There are individuals who have amazing knowledge of themselves, of the things that go on in themselves. But even those people wouldn't be capable of knowing what is going on in their own cultures.
Yes.
For instance, they are not conscious of the fact that while they live a conscious life, all the time a myth is played in the unconscious. A myth that extends over centuries.
Yes.
Namely, archetypal ideas, a stream of archetypal ideas that goes on through one individual, through the centuries.
Yes.
You see, it is like a continuous stream.
Yes.
And that comes into the daylight in the great movements.
Yes.
Say, in political movements or in spiritual movements. For instance, in the time before Reformation, people dreamt of the great change. And that's the reason why such great transformations could be predicted.
Yeah.
If somebody has been clever enough to see what is going on in people's mind, in the unconscious mind,
yeah.
Would be able to predict it. For instance,
yeah.
I have predicted the Nazi rising in Germany through the observation of my German patients.
Yes.
They had dreams in which the whole thing was anticipated.
Yes.
And with considerable detail. And I was already absolutely certain in the years before Hitler came, in the beginning of the, well, I could say the year 1919, I was sure that something was threatening in Germany, something very big and very catastrophic. And I only knew it through the observation of the unconscious.
Okay,
you see, there is something very particular in the different nations. And this is a peculiar fact that the archetype of the anima plays a very great role in Western literature, French and Anglo-Saxon,
yes.
Not in Germany.
Yes.
There are exceedingly few examples in German literature where the anima plays a role.
Yes.
You know, that simply comes from the fact that not one woman is buried unless she is buried as Alt Kaminfeger's Gattin, at least.
Yes. Yes.
She must have a title, otherwise she hasn't existed.
That's right.
And so, you see, it is just as if, now mind you, this is a bit drastic, but it illustrates my point. In Germany, there are no women. There is Frau Doktor, Frau Professor, Frau Kommerzienrat, the grandmother, the mother-in-law, the grandfather, father, the son, the daughter, the sister. No woman.
Yes, I see.
La femme.
La femme.
So next is the pot.
Doesn't exist. Well,
it is the idea,
yeah.
You see. Now that is an enormous important fact, which shows that in the German mind, there is going on a particular myth, something very particular.
Yeah.
And psychologists really should look out for these things.
Yeah.
But they prefer to think that I am a prophet.
Yeah. Ha! Now, just in the same context of journey, this is, of course, a very interesting and remarkable set of statements here. How would you look at Hitler in this light? Would you see him as a personification, a symbol of the Father?
Oh, well, no, no.
No.
No, not at all.
No, no.
No, you see, I couldn't possibly explain that very complicated fact Hitler represents. It is too complicated, you know. He's a hero figure.
Yes.
And the hero figure is far more important than any fathers that have ever existed.
I see. Much broader than
the
immediate father.
No, he was not a father at all. Not at all. He was a hero.
Yes.
In the German myth.
Yes.
And, mind you, a religious hero. He was a savior.
Yes.
He was meant to be a savior. That is why they put his photo upon the altars.
Yes.
Even.
Yes.
Or somebody declared on his tombstone that he is happy to that his eyes have beheld Hitler.
Yes.
And now he can die in peace. So he's just the hero myth, you know.
Yes. Now, getting back to the idea of the self, and the self incorporates these unconscious factors. The self incorporates these unconscious
factors. The self is merely a term that designates the whole personality.
Whole personality.
Because the whole personality of man is indescribable.
Yes.
His consciousness can be described. His unconscious cannot
Not
be described,
right.
Because the unconscious, as I must repeat myself,
yes.
is always unconscious.
Yes.
And is really unconscious, but really does not know it.
Does not know about it.
And so we don't know our unconscious personality. We have hints, we have certain ideas, but we don't know it really. Nobody can say where man ends.
Yes.
That is the beauty of it, you know.
Yes.
It's very interesting.
Yes.
The unconscious of man can reach God knows where. There we are going to make discoveries.
Yes. Now, another set of ideas, which of course are very, very well known to the world, that of course you have originated, center around the terms introversion and extroversion.
Yeah.
And I know that you're aware of the fact that these terms have now become so widely known that the man on the street is using these terms constantly in describing his wife or his friends and so on and so forth. It's become probably the most used psychological concepts by the layman that we have.
Oh, like the word complex. I have invented it too.
That yes,
on
that's
the
right.
Association experiments.
Yes, that's right.
Well, you see, this is simply practical because there are certain people who definitely are more influenced by their surroundings than by their own intentions. While there are other people who are more influenced by the subjective factor. Now you see, the subjective factor, that's very characteristic, was understood by Freud as a sort of pathological autoerotism.
Yes, yes.
Now this is a mistake. You know, we have, the psyche has two conditions, two important conditions. The one is the environmental influence.
Yes, yes.
And the other is the given fact of the psyche as it is born. The psyche is by no means tabula rasa. We are a definite mixture and combination of genes.
Yes.
And they are there from the very first moment of our life. And they give a definite character, even to the little child. And that is a subjective factor, looked at from the outside. Now, if you look at it from the inside,
yes.
then it is just so as if you would observe the world.
Yes.
When you observe the world, you see people, you see houses, you see the sky, you see tangible objects. But when you observe yourself within, you see moving images.
Yes.
A world of images.
Yes.
Generally known as fantasies.
Fantasies.
Yet these fantasies are facts. You see, it is a fact that a man has such and such a fantasy. And it is such a tangible fact, for instance, that when a man has a certain fantasy, another man may lose his life.
Yes.
Or a bridge is built.
Yes.
These houses were all fantasies.
Yes.
Everything you do here, all
That's
of
right.
houses, everything was fantasy to begin with. And the fantasy has a proper reality. It is, that is not to be forgotten. Fantasy is not nothing. It is, of course, not a tangible object, but it is a fact nevertheless. It is, a form of energy.
Yes.
Despite the fact we can't measure it.
Yes.
It is a manifestation of something.
Yes.
And that is a reality. That is just a reality as, for instance, the peace treaty of Versailles or something like that. Yes. It is no more. You can't show it.
Yes.
But it has been a fact.
Yes. Yes.
And so the psychical events are facts, are realities. And when you observe the stream of images within, you observe an aspect of the world.
Yes.
Of the world within. Because the psyche, you know, if you understand it as a phenomenon that takes place in so-called living bodies, then it is a quality of matter. As our body consists of matter, we discover that this matter has another aspect, namely a psychic aspect.
Yes. Yes.
And so it is simply the world from within, seen from within.
Yes.
It is just as if we were seeing into another aspect of matter.
Yes.
This is an idea that is not my invention, that the old Democritus already said, talked of the spiritus insertus atomis,
yes.
Namely the spirit that is inserted in atoms.
Yes, yes.
That means psyche is a quality that appears in matter. Doesn't matter whether we understand it or not,
yes.
But this is the conclusion we come to.
Yes.
If we draw conclusions without prejudices. And so, you see, the man who is going by the external world, by the influences of the external world, say, society or perceptions, sense perceptions, thinks that he is more valid, you know, because this is valid, this is real. And the man who goes by the subjective factor is not valid because subjective factor is nothing.
Yeah.
No, that man is just as well based. Because he is bases himself upon the world from within.
Yes.
And so he is quite right, even if he says, oh, this is nothing but my fantasy, you know.
Yes.
And of course that is the introvert. And as the introvert is always afraid of the external world, he will tell you, when you ask him, he will be apologetic about it. You say, of course, yes, I know those are my fantasies. And he has always resentment. And as the world in general, particularly America, is extroverted like hell, the introvert has no place.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because he doesn't know that he beholds the world from within.
Yeah.
And that gives him dignity. And that gives him certainty. Because it is, nowadays particularly, the world hangs on a thin thread.
Yeah.
And that is the psyche of man.
Yeah.
Assume that certain fellows in Moscow lose their nerve or their compensates for a bit. And the whole world is in fire and flames.
Yeah, yeah.
It is, nowadays we are not threatened by elementary catastrophes. There is no such thing as an H-bomb.
Yeah.
That is all man's doing.
Yeah.
We are the great danger. The psyche is the great danger. What if something goes wrong with the psyche?
Yeah. Yeah.
See? And so you see, it is demonstrated to us in our days what the power of the psyche is of man, how important it is to know something about it, but we know nothing about it. Nobody would give credit to the idea that the psychical processes of the ordinary man have any importance whatever. One thinks, oh, he has just what he has in his head, it is all from his surroundings, he's taught such a thing, believes such a thing. And particularly if he's well housed and well fed, then he has no ideas at all. And that's the great mistake. Because he is just that as which he is born, and he's not born as tabula rasa, but as a reality.
Yes. Now, of course, one of the very common, I think, misconceptions of your work among some of the writers in America have been that they have sort of characterized your discussions of introversion and extroversion as suggesting that the world was made up of only two kinds of people, introverts on one hand and extroverts on the other. And I'm sure you've been aware of in many of our people looking at things this way. And, of course, would you like to comment about that? In other words, would you perceive the world being made up of only people or extreme introverts, people that are extreme extroverts?
Well, you know, Bismarck once said, God may protect me against my friends. With my enemies, I can deal myself alone. You know how people are. They catch a word, and then everything is schematized along that word. There is no such thing as a pure extrovert or a pure introvert.
Yes.
Such a man would be in the lunatic asylum. Those are only terms to designate a certain penchant, a certain tendency. For instance, the tendency to be more influenced by environmental influences or more influenced by the subjective factor. That's all.
Yes.
And you see, there are people who are fairly well balanced and are just as much influenced from within as they are from without,
yes.
Or just as little.
Yes.
And so with all the finer classifications, you know,
yes.
they are only sort of point de repère, points for orientation.
Certainly then, this whole matter of extremes, introversion, extroversion, it just, as you say, it's sort of a schematic approach to sort of hang an idea, an approach.
Yeah.
But it would be, as you say, ridiculous to say
you
that
see,
people...
The whole, my whole scheme of typology is merely a sort of orientation. Namely, there is such a factor as introversion, there is such a factor as extroversion. The classification of individuals means nothing, nothing at all. This is only the instrumentarium for the practical psychologist to explain, for instance, a husband to a wife, or vice versa. For instance, it is very often the case, one could almost say, it is almost a rule, but I don't want to make too many rules, you see, in order not to be schematic, that an introvert marries an extrovert for compensation, or another type marries the counter type to complement himself, for instance.
Well, Dr. Jung, of course, tied in with your typology and quotation marks of introversion and extroversion, we, of course, know of your concepts of thinking, feeling, sensation, and intuition. And, of course, it would be very interesting to hear some expansion of the meaning of these particular terms as related to the introvert-extrovert dichotomy.
Well, there is quite a simple explanation of these terms, and it shows at the same time how I arrived at such a typology. Namely, sensation tells you that there is something. Thinking, roughly speaking, tells you what it is. Feeling tells you whether it is agreeable or not, to be accepted or not, accepted or rejected.
Yes.
And intuition out there is a difficulty.
Yes.
You don't know ordinarily how intuition works. So when a man has a hunch, you can't tell exactly how he got at that hunch or where that hunch comes from. It is something funny about intuition. I will tell you a little story. I had two patients. the man was a sensation type, and the woman was an intuitive type. Of course, they felt attraction. And so they took a little boat and went out to the lake of Zurich. And there were those birds that dive after fish, you know.
Yeah.
And then after a certain time, they come up again, and you can't tell where they come up. And so they began to bet. Who first was the first to see the bird? Now, you would think that the one who observes reality very carefully, the sensation type, would of course win out.
Yes.
Not at all. The woman won the bet completely.
Yes.
She was beating him on all points.
Yes.
Because by intuition she knew it before.
I see.
See? Now, how is that possible?
Yeah.
Well, sometimes, you know, you can really find out how it works by finding the intermediate links. You see, it is a perception by intermediate links, and you only get the result of that whole chain of yeah. associations.
Yeah.
Sometimes you succeed in finding out,
yeah.
but more often you don't. So my definition is, intuition is a perception by ways or means of the unconscious.
Yes.
That is as near as I can get. Now this is a very important function, because when you live under primitive conditions, a lot of unpredictable things are likely to happen.
Yes.
And there you need your intuition. Because you cannot possibly tell by your perceptions, by your sense perceptions, what there is going to happen. For instance, you are traveling in primeval forest. You only see for a few steps ahead. Mm-hmm. You go by the compass, perhaps, and you don't know what there is ahead. It is uncharted country. If you use your intuition, then you have hunches. And when you live under such primitive conditions, you instantly are aware of hunches. For instance, there are places that are favorable, there are places that are not favorable. You can't tell for your life what it is.
Yeah.
But you better follow these hunches.
Yeah.
Because anything can happen. Quite unforeseen things. For instance, at the end of a long day, you approach a river, and you don't know that there is a river. Yet, when you come to the river, that is quite unexpected. For miles there is no human habitation. You cannot swim across, it's all full of crocodiles. So what? You see? Mm-hmm. Now, such an obstacle hasn't been foreseen. But it may be that you have had a hunch, that you remained in the last likely spot, and that you wait for the following day, that you can build a raft or something
yeah.
of the sort, or look out for possibilities. For instance, you also can have intuitions and that constantly happens, in our jungle called a city.
Yeah.
you can be have a hunch, something is going wrong, particularly when you are driving an automobile.
Yeah.
For instance, it is a day where nurses appear in the street.
Yeah.
And they always try to get something interesting, like a suicide, you know,
yeah.
to be run over, that's what marvelous, apparently.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you get a peculiar feeling, and really, at the next corner, already is a second nurse that runs in front of the automobile.
Yeah.
You see? Duplicity of cases, you know,
yeah.
That is a rule, you know, that such chance happenings
yeah.
come in groups.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so you see, we have constantly warnings, hints that are course is perhaps in a slight feeling of uneasiness, uncertainty, fear. Now, under primitive circumstances, you pay attention to these things. They mean something. With us in our man-made, absolutely, apparently safe conditions, we don't need that function so very much.
Yes.
Yet we still use it. So you find intuitive types, for instance, amongst bankers. Mm-hmm. Wall Street men.
Yeah.
They follow hunches, you know. Gamblers of all descriptions.
Yeah.
You find the type very frequently among doctors. Yeah. Because it helps them in their prognosis. Sometimes a case can look quite normal, as it were, and you don't foresee any complications. Yet, an inner voice tells you, now look out, here is something not quite all right, you know.
Yes, yes.
You cannot tell why and how, but we have a lot of subliminal perceptions, you
yes,
know,
yes.
Sense perceptions. And from those, we probably draw a good deal of our intuitions, but that is perception by the way of the unconscious.
Yeah.
And you can observe that with intuitive types. You see, intuitive types very often do not perceive by their eyes or by their ears. They perceive by intuition. For instance, once it happened that I had a woman patient in the morning at 9 o'clock. And you see, I often smoke my pipe and there is a certain smell of tobacco in the room, or a cigar. And so she came and said, but you begin earlier. I said, you call it earlier at 9 o'clock? But no, you must have seen somebody at 8 o'clock. I said, how do you know? There had been a man there that had come at 8 o'clock already. Then she said, oh, well, I just a hunch. There must have been a gentleman with you this morning. I said, how do you know it was a gentleman? He said, oh, well, I just had the impression, the atmosphere was just like,
yeah,
like a gentleman here.
Yeah.
All the time, you know, the ashtray was under her nose, and there was a half-smoked cigar. But she wouldn't notice it.
Yeah.
So you see, the intuitive is a type that doesn't see the stumbling block before his feet. But he's had for 10 miles.
Yes. Do you make a distinction between an intuitive extrovert and an intuitive introvert?
Introvert, yes. All these types can be introverted line.
For example, more specifically, what would be an example or a difference between an intuitive extrovert and an intuitive introvert?
Well, you know, you have chosen a somewhat difficult case, you know, because one of the most difficult types is the intuitive introvert,
yes,
you know. The intuitive extrovert you find among hunters, bankers,
yes,
gamblers.
Yes, yes, yes.
That is quite understandable.
Yes.
But the introvert is the introverted variety is more difficult because he has intuitions as to the subjective factor, namely the inner world.
Yes.
And of course that is now very difficult to understand because what he sees are most uncommon things and he doesn't like to talk of them.
Yes.
If he's not a fool, because he would spoil his own game by telling what he sees. Because people won't understand it.
Yes.
For instance, once I had a patient, a young woman, about 27 or 8, and her first words were, when I had seated her, said, you know, doctor, I come to you because I have a snake in my abdomen. I said, what? Yes, a snake, a black snake, coiled up right in the bottom of my abdomen. And I must have made a rather bewildered face at her. And she said, you know, I don't mean it literally, but I should say it was a snake. It was a snake. Now, you see, our further conversation a little later was, as she said, that was about in the middle of our treatment, that only lasted for 10 consultations. She had foretold me, I come 10 times, and then it's all right. I said, how do you know? Oh, I got a hunch, you see.
Yeah.
And really, about the fifth or sixth hour, she said, doctor, I must tell you, the snake has risen. It is now about here. hunch. And then, on the tenth day, I said, now, this is our last hour. And do you feel cured? And she said, beaming, she said, you know, this morning, it came up and came out of my mouth, and the head was golden. Mm. And those were her last words. Mm. Now, you see, that same girl, when it comes to reality, she came to me because she couldn't hear the step of her feet anymore.
Yes.
Because she walked on air.
Yes.
Literally.
Yes.
She couldn't hear it, and that frightened her. And when she came to me, I asked her for her address. And then she said, oh, pension so-and-so. Well, it is not just called pension, but it is a sort of pension. And it is, I never had heard of it.
Yeah.
And now, I'm curious, I never have heard of that place. Well, it's a very nice place, she said. Curious enough, there are only young girls there, very nice and very lively young girls. And they have a merry time. I often wish they would invite me to their merry evenings. And I said, but they amuse themselves all alone. Said, oh no, there are plenty of young gentlemen coming in. And they have a beautiful time, but they never invite me. It turned out that it was a private brother.
Yes.
And she was a perfectly decent girl, you know, of a very good family. Not from here. She had found that place, I don't know how. And she was utterly unaware that those were all prostitutes. I said, for heaven's sake, you fell into a very dark place. You hastened to get out of it. You see, that was her sensation.
Yeah.
You see, she didn't see reality.
Yeah.
But she had hunches like anything, and they came off.
Yeah.
Now, you see, such a person cannot possibly speak of her experiences.
Yes.
Because everybody would think she's absolutely crazy.
Yeah.
I myself was quite shocked when I thought, for heaven's sake, is that case a schizophrenia?
Yeah.
Because you don't hear that kind of speech.
Right.
But she assumed that the old man, of course, knows everything, and he even does understands such kind of language. So you see, if when the intuitive introverted intuitive would speak what he really perceives, then practically nobody would understand it. He would be misunderstood. And so they learn to keep things to themselves. And you hardly ever hear them talking of these things. That is a great disadvantage. But it is an enormous advantage in another way. Not to speak of the experience they gather in that respect, but also in human relations. For instance, they come into the presence of somebody they don't know, and certainly they have inner images. And those inner images give them a more or less complete information about the psychology of the partner.
Yeah.
You know, that is, but the case can also happen that they come into the presence of somebody who they don't know at all, not from man, and they know an important piece out of the biography of that person.
Yeah. Yes, yes.
And are not aware of it. And tell the story.
Yes.
Identify this in the fire.
Yes, that's right.
You see? So the introverted intuitive has a very difficult life, although one of the most interesting lives.
Yes.
But it is difficult often to get into their confidence,
yes,
you know.
Yes, because you say they're afraid that people will think they're sick.
The things that are interesting to them or are vital to them are utterly strange to the ordinary individual. The psychologists should know of such things, you see?
Yes.
You see, when people make psychology as a psychologist ought to do, well, the very first question is he extroverted or is he introverted?
Yes.
He will look at entirely different things.
Yes.
Is he a sensation type? Is he an intuitive type? Is he thinking? Is he feeling?
Yes.
That, because you see, these things are complicated that they are still more complicated because the introverted thinker, for instance, is compensated by extroverted feeling,
yeah,
or by inferior extroverted, archaic extroverted feeling.
Yeah.
So an introverted thinker may be very crude in his feeling life, for instance. The introverted philosopher, that is always carefully avoiding women, will be married by his cook in the end.
Yes. Now, then, in other words, then we can take your introvert and extrovert categories and, in a sense, go through describing a sensation introvert type, sensation extrovert type, thinking introvert type, thinking extrovert type, and so on. In each case, it stems from really not real category, but simply, as you say, an approach, something to sort of help us,
yes,
study, a model.
Well, it is just a sort of a skeleton, to which you have to add the flesh, or a country mapped out, you know, by triangulation points, and that doesn't mean the country consists of triangulation points.
Yeah.
That is only in order to have an idea of the distances.
Yes.
And so it is a means to an end. It only makes sense, such a scheme, when you deal with practical cases.
Of course, you're familiar with the work of Dr. J.B. Ryan at Duke University.
Yes, yes, yes.
And of course, some of his work in extrasensory perception and clairvoyance, as he calls
yes,
it,
yes.
Mental telepathy, you know,
yeah,
and
yeah,
so
yeah.
on and so forth. Some of the descriptions in his work sound quite a bit at times like intuitive function operating. And in terms of your knowledge of this work, would you say that a person who has clairvoyance, in
yes.
a sense, would then be an intuitive type? Person in his experiment more likely to.
That's quite probable. Or it can be a sensation type, say an extroverted sensation type that is very much influenced by the unconscious.
I see.
Because he has introverted intuition in his unconscious.
I see.
You see, there are two groups, you see, the rational group and the irrational group. The rational group is thinking and feeling, because the ideal thinking is a rational result.
That's right.
Feeling also a rational result, rational values.
Yes.
That is differentiated feeling. Whereas sensation must needs be irrational, because it may not prejudice facts.
Yes.
You see?
Yeah.
It shall not prejudice facts. The real ideal perception is that you have an accurate perception of the things as they are, without addition or corrections.
Yeah.
On the other side, the intuition does not look at the things as they are. That is prison, that is anathema to the intuition.
Yeah.
It looks, ever so shortly, at the things as they are, and makes off into an unconscious process, at the end of which we have seen something nobody else would have seen.
Yes.
You see. Now, so we see these people who yield the best results are always those people where introverted introverted intuition comes in.
Yes.
But you see, that is a side aspect of it. It's not interesting.
Yeah.
There the question is another question, far more interesting. Namely, that the terms they use, Ryan himself uses them,
yes.
Precognition, telepathy,
pre-recognition, yes.
etc. They mean nothing at all.
Yes.
They're worse. But he thinks he has said something when he says telepathy. That's nothing.
In other words, the word itself is not a description of the process.
It's
that's what you're
saying.
Yes.
It means nothing. It means nothing at all.
Yes. Now, of course, a lot of the things that you're describing, I think often, scientists will say, well, this is due to chance. Chance occurrences, chance factors. And Ryan, in his own work, used statistical methods. We find this happening more often than would be expected by chance.
Well, you see, he proves that it is more than chance.
Yes.
It is statistically graspable.
Yes.
And that is the important point.
Yes.
And that hasn't been contradicted.
Yes.
You see, there was such a poor sap that happened in England. The man said, oh, Ryan, well, that's nothing but guesswork. Exactly.
Yes.
That is it. It is guessing.
Yeah.
What you call guessing, a hunch is guessing.
Yeah.
A bit of definite guess, you know, is a hunch, you know,
yeah.
just that.
Yeah.
But that means nothing.
Yeah.
You see, the point is that it is more than merely probable.
Yeah.
It is not. It is beyond chance.
Yeah.
And that is the great problem. But you know, people hate such problems they can't deal with.
Yes, they're not concrete. They're not in front of them.
They can't deal with it.
Yes.
Even Ryan doesn't understand my argument in that respect, because it is a relativation. Now I'm going to say something which in these sacred rooms is anathema. relativation of time and space through the psyche. And that's the fact.
Yes.
And that is what Ryan has made evident.
Yeah.
Now swallow that.
Well,
that's difficult. Yes.
Well, may I go a little further? And of course, some of your recent work, which is indeed very profound, and it is not too well known to many of our students as
yet. Of course not.
And of course, this
nobody
is
reads these things. Only the general public.
And
because my books are at least sold.
I'm referring now to. The concept of synchronicity, which you have discussed, and which would have some relevance at this point in our discussion. Would you care to comment a little bit on this concept?
See, that is awfully complicated. One wouldn't know where to begin. Of course, it is this kind of thinking has been started long ago, and when Ryan brought out these results, I thought now we have at least a more or less dependable basis to argue on, you know. But the argument was not understood at all, because it's really very, very difficult. You know, there are plenty of facts in the observation of the unconscious where you come across cases of a very peculiar kind of parallel events. Namely that, say, I have a certain thought or a certain definite subject is occupying my attention,
yeah.
my interest. At the same time, something else, quite independently, happens that portrays just that thought.
Yes.
Now, this is utter nonsense, you know, looked at from a causal point of view. That it is not nonsense is made evident by the results of Ryan's experiments. There is a probability, it is something more than chance, that such a case occurs. Now I have, I never made statistical experiments,
yes,
to except one in the way of Ryan. I have made one for another purpose. But I have come across quite a number of cases where it was most astounding to find that two causal chains happened at the same time, but independent upon each other, so that you could say they have nothing to do with each other.
Yeah.
Of course, it's quite clear. For instance, just so I speak of a red car, and at that moment a red car comes here, you see?
Yes.
Now, I hadn't seen it. It was impossible because it was behind the building. In this moment, the red car appears. Now, this is, that's mere chance. The Ryan's experiment proves that these cases are not mere chances. Of course, many of these things are occurrences where we cannot apply such an argument, otherwise we would be superstitious. We can't say, now this car has appeared because here was some remarks have been made about the red car.
Yes. It's not cause and effect.
Oh, this is a miracle that the red car appears. It is not, it is chance.
Yes.
Just chance. But these chances happen more often than chance allows.
Yes.
And that shows that there is something behind it.
Yes.
So you see, Ryan has a whole institute and with many co-workers.
Yes.
And has the means. We have no means here, you know, and I had no means to make such experiments, otherwise I probably would have done them. But it was physically impossible. So I had to content myself with the observation of facts.
Does anybody really know the secret or the combination for this life and where to keep it? It's kind of sad when you don't know the meaning, but everything happens for a reason.
Much the government is trying to murder me. No coming back, like cutting your wrists open vertically. How could the serpent be purposely put in charge of the country?